the seat in front of you, you'll find it. And you can pull those out, fill it out, let us know you're here. This is one way that you can get to know us as the church, and we get to know you. Yes, that's exactly right, Lexi. It's right there. And for everybody, if you have a prayer request, on the back side of these cards, you can put a prayer request. And then when offering comes around, you can drop those in the offering basket. Our staff gathers together, and we pray over every single prayer request every week. And so this morning, as we enter into Advent, this time of preparing our hearts for the arrival of Christ Jesus, let us meditate as the choir sings, and we have a video for you just to capture these images that are presented during the Advent season. Let us worship together.
We'll be reading from the book of Isaiah, 40th chapter, verse 3 through 5. A voice of one calling, in the wilderness, prepare a way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain made low. The rough ground shall become level, and the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed in all of us. We will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Today, we'll light the candle of expectation and hope. May it remind each and every one of us of our God's great promise to us. He is our hope, our Redeemer, and our Savior. We bow our heads in prayer. Father, during this Advent season, may we be reminded of your promises to us and your fulfillment of them. Help us to prepare our lives for his advent within us. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Russ. Today we celebrate hope, and the hope that we have in Jesus, that he has come to save us all. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with us as we prepare to worship? Hands together like this. We have hope this morning. Hallelujah.
For unto us a child is born, a son is given, a son is given. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, a son is given. The Messiah. Oh, to see him high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Sing for unto us.
For unto us a child is born, a son is given. A son is given. For unto us a child is born.
A son is given.
A son is given. The Messiah. Oh, to see him
high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love. As we sing, holy, 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 you are high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy.
Can we all sing holy?
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy. Let's sing holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. You are holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy. Us a child is born, holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born, holy, holy, holy.
it going.
For unto us a child is born, holy, holy, holy. For unto us a child is born, holy, holy, holy.
Hallelujah. Can we all say holy, holy, holy? Yes. Amen.
So this morning, you have a seat. We have the privilege of celebrating communion. And communion is a sacrament. It is something that not only Jesus gave as an example, but it was also something he commanded his believers to continue to do. And so when we come to the communion table, we invite all who profess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We also, as parents, as we're raising our kids, we discern when the time is, when they're ready to partake in communion. When we believe that they have made that commitment to Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so as we come together, we come around a table. We come as the family of God, as brothers and sisters. So this morning, we begin with a confession of prayer. Scripture tells us that we want to make sure that there's nothing in between us and God. And so we will say a confession of prayer together. The words will be on the screen. And then there'll be a time of silence for you to just pray silently with God. And so will you pray with me? It is never easy for us to confess our sins, waiting God. There are the hurts we have caused to our family and friends, which we would like to forget. There are those we believe are impossible to love, and so we don't try. There are people who live on the edge of our society, and we ignore their cries for help. Forgive us, God, who comes near to us when we have lost our way. Show us yours. Lead us in humility down the streets of your kingdom. Teach us your truth so that we might be able to keep your word revealed to us in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Now take a moment of silence. Scripture says that God does not remember our sins. In fact, he says that he separates us from our sins as far as the east is from the west. And he remembers the promises that he has made to us. God does not shame us, but lifts us to new life, a transformed life, leads us in his hope, and teaches us his love. God, you are the God of our days, and we wait for you to come again. Amen. And so, on the night of Jesus' arrest, he sat down with his disciples at a table, and he took the bread. And after giving thanks to God, he took it and he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of sins, sealed in my blood for you." And again he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And so this is the good news. Every time we take of this cup and we eat of this bread, we proclaim the saving death of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes again. This is what he encouraged and instructed his disciples to do, and this is what we continue to do. So with joy in our hearts, we acknowledge that we receive forgiveness from God. We receive our salvation from God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we come this morning as brothers and sisters, as God's family, to celebrate what God has done for us. Will you join me in prayer? Lord of all, we offer our praise and thanksgiving to you. Send your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup. Unite us to your Son in his death and resurrection, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Hold us in your promise to bring all things together under Christ. In the fullness of time, and bring us to the heavenly feast, where with all your saints we will be gathered in glory everlasting through Jesus Christ, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, the author of our salvation. And as the Lord taught us to pray, the words will be on the screen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So when you are ready, the communion servers can come forward. When you are ready, take your time if you need to sit in your seats. But we will ask that this section here and half of the middle section would go down this aisle, receive the communion, and then exit this aisle. And if the other half of the middle section and this section would go down this aisle, receive the elements and exit the same aisle. But please take your time as we prepare our hearts to receive God's body and blood. Christ's body broken for you, Christ's blood shed for you.
hear the angel song that rings so sweet and clear. When heaven's light and music fell, and mercy found us here. Glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the angels sing. He came to tell the Father's love, His goodness and His grace, to show the brightness of His smile, the glory of His face. So glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, your children sing. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace for all eternity. To lift the weary ones, give peace and perfect rest, to take away our burdens and to give a glorious gift. So glory in the highest, and on the earth be peace. Glory to God, the world will sing. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace for all eternity. Oh, His name shall be Wonderful Counselor.
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of your body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen.
Our heads once again in prayer over our offering. Lord God, what a gift. We would just want to bring this offering of worship to you, our King, our Lord, our Savior, our friend, our brother. We are so thankful for the blessing of your birth, Jesus. And so we give back to you our first fruits. We give back to you our best. To bring this offering to you, Lord, in appreciation for all that you have done for us, Lord, as we partner with you, just as you came to not be served, but to serve others, Lord, we also want to serve others. And so we want to have our eyes open and our hearts and our ears open to you, to where you might be moving in our world, Lord God, that we could partner with you in this offering, that it might be used to glorify you and love our world, Lord Jesus. Would you give us a spirit of peace and joy and hope and love as we go out and love others the way that you have loved us, Lord Jesus. We're so thankful. We give you all of this in your precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, as the ushers pass the plates, if you don't know me, my name is Amy. I am the Director of Worship and Communications here at Hillmark Covenant. It is a blessing to be here with you this morning. Just as Pastor Catherine mentioned earlier, if you filled out one of those welcome cards, please put it in the plates as they are passed. This is one way that we can get to know you. Just as Pastor Catherine said, we pray over the prayer requests that are on the back of those cards every week as a staff, and we want to join you in prayer. So please place those in the plates so we can get to know you better and you can get to know us better.
We have a ton of exciting stuff happening at Hillmark Covenant.
Who are you?
I was getting to it. My name is Ashley. Hi. And I work with K through 12th graders here at Hillmark Covenant. I am I am the Director of Students and Children's Ministry here at Hillmark Covenant.
All right.
I have to remember it. And we have something maybe not so exciting for everyone, but I think it's so exciting that we as a congregation get to take part in this. But we have our congregational meeting next. Oh, never mind. I'm doing the hymn sing. That works. Perfect. We have a congregational meeting next Sunday, December 8th, directly following service in here in the sanctuary. And the reason I say it's exciting, even though it has meeting attached to it, is that us as members of Hillmark Covenant Church, we get to come together and partner with God and see what he is doing and plan what he will do in the year of 2025. So we hope that you're... We hope that if you are a member, you will join us, or if you simply just want to know what we have planned for 2025 and how God's going to help us in that, then join us as well. We will have childcare available as well, awesome. And this is for kids specifically, like kindergarten or younger, to fifth grade. So anyone over fifth grade, we do ask that you guys sit quietly in the meeting.
Awesome. Thanks, Ashley. We also are so excited about tonight. Tonight is our Advent hymn sing. It will be right here in the sanctuary at 6:30 p.m. We would love to see you there for a time of worship and fellowship, and just continue in our Sunday worship in this way. So we would love to see you tonight at 6:30 right here for some worship.
And then I'm gonna let you hit the slide so I know what I'm doing next. There we go. We would like to invite you guys to a Christmas movie night happening Friday, December 6th. That is this Friday at 6:30 p.m. in our gym. This is a free movie night for our community as well as our church family. We will have, I think, hot chocolate and cookies. And so please take some invites. They're spread around on the tables in the back of the church. And invite your friends and family. As I said, we'll have popcorn, cookies, hot chocolate.
Free hot chocolate.
Yes. Because what better way do we celebrate watching?
And it will be inside. So it will be inside. You'll be nice and warm. You can bring blankets if you want, just for funsies. But we will be inside this time, not outside.
So we'd love to see you there. Join us for this movie night. And as I said, please invite your friends, families, and neighbors.
Yeah. And with that?
And with that, oh, that's it. I had four in my mind for some reason. Kids, go ahead and come on forward. Have a seat up on the stage. And as they do, to fit with the season, we will be learning about Christmas this month. And today we will start that. And I am very excited for us to begin to hear this lesson or this story about Jesus's birth and all that kind of fun stuff. Are you guys... Run, we got one more. You're the next contestant on The Price is Right. are you guys ready to go to Kids Space? Sweet. On the count of three, let's go ahead and say, may the Lord be with you. Ready? One, two, three.
Sweetest thing, I'm sitting in the front row and I hear this little voice behind me that says, when I grow up, I'm going to be just like Daddy and play the cajon. So that was pretty darn sweet. So before you get settled into your seats, why don't you stand up and greet somebody in the name of the Lord? All right, as you guys find your seats. I love all the greeting that is taking place. So I don't know if it's like this in your family, but today is the official day that we get to start watching Christmas movies. No, and playing Christmas music. So I have to say, it is restricted in our house until after Thanksgiving. So we are excited to begin the Advent season. So in 2018, my family embarked on a cross-country journey. We knew where our destination was going to be. But we had a rough idea of how we were going to get there. And along the way, we used maps, we used road signs, we used internet searches for places to see along the way. And we visited picturesque places in nature. We saw historic sites and read what happened in those locations. And we got to engage with cultural landmarks. Of course, there was Graceland. Each spot really did change us. We either grew in knowledge or we grew in our appreciation of God's creation. But without those road signs, without the map, we would have become lost and discouraged. missing many of the life-changing experiences that we had. Today, we begin the season of Advent. It is the first 4 weeks, the 4 weeks preceding Christmas in the church calendar, dedicated to preparing and anticipating the arrival or advent of Christ Jesus. We lit the candle of hope and read from the prophet Isaiah. For centuries, God has been placing road signs and a map to bring us on a journey of revelation. God has spoken through his prophets, promises, and visions to reveal his plan of redemption through Jesus. Well before the Roman Empire in 27 BC, so that is before the birth of Christ, 27 years, and even before the Assyrian Empire, which was established in the 4th century BCE, God was speaking to his people. Biblical scholars state that there are over 300 Old Testament prophecies about Jesus. These are prophecies that Jesus fulfilled. And these prophecies begin in Genesis and span all the way to Malachi. So just to kind of put it in perspective, Malachi was written 400 years before Jesus was born. Isaiah was written 700 years before Jesus was born. Psalms was written 1,000 years before. And Genesis was written roughly 4,000 years before the birth of Christ. So 4,000 years before the fulfillment of these prophecies took place, God was speaking to his people. The prophecies we have are all the way back to Genesis 3. 4,000 years. Peter Stoner, a chairman of the Department of Mathematics and Astronomy at Pasadena College, worked with a team from InterVarsity, and they took 8 of these specific Old Testament prophecies about Jesus. And they came up with an extremely conservative probability for each one being fulfilled by Jesus, or being fulfilled at all, and then considered the likelihood of Jesus fulfilling all 8 of them. So this is just 8 of the over 300 that are in Scripture. And they came up with the prospect that anyone would satisfy those 8 prophecies was 1 in 10 to the 17th power. That's pretty amazing. If you are not sitting in your seat and going, wow, I would be shocked. God fulfilled over 300 of these Old Testament prophecies in Jesus. So that is, I mean, to me, it is just amazing to look at. This morning, we're going to look at several of the prophecies about Jesus, focusing only in the book of Isaiah. And we begin with a prophecy about Jesus' birth, and it's found in Isaiah 7, verse 14. The scripture will be on the screen, or you can turn in your Bible. We will be flipping back and forth between Isaiah and the New Testament. And Isaiah 7:14 says, "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. So Isaiah prophesied during the time of King Ahaz, which was during a time where Judah, the kingdom of Judah, it was after Israel separated into 2 kingdoms. I'm sorry, I'm going to nerd out a little bit. And he separated into 2 kingdoms, and Judah was being threatened by neighboring kingdoms because Judah refused to join these other kingdoms. They were being threatened by them. And then not only that, they had the oppression of the Assyrian empire. So the Assyrians, which was a particularly brutal empire, brutal people, they were oppressing all of that region. And so in this particular time when Isaiah spoke to King Ahaz, the circumstances surrounding Judah seemed hopeless. They were beginning to say, did God really say that he will help us? They felt abandoned by God as they looked around and they saw what was going on. They felt like they began to doubt. They doubted, like, can God really do what he says? Because he's not coming to save us. And without King Ahaz asking, the prophet Isaiah gives him a prophecy to remind him that God is still with his people. And the fact that a virgin would be overshadowed by God's Spirit and conceive and give birth, it would remind God's people that God is real and he fulfills his promises. And this would encourage the people and give them a reason to live courageously and unselfishly for God. Here, the mother gives birth, or gives the name to the child, Emmanuel, God with us. It's interesting, this particular name does not occur anywhere else in the Old Testament, Emmanuel. And it was highly unusual for a mother to name a child. It was usually the duty of the father to, and privilege of the father to name the child. But if the father was unavailable to name the child, then the task would fall on the mother. So jumping 700 years into the future, Luke recounts the events leading to Jesus' birth. And an angel appears to a young woman named Mary. And in Luke 1, verse 30, the angel appears and says, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And God, the Lord God, will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever, and his kingdom will have no end." Just in that little section right there was a fulfillment of the Messiah, messianic prophecy that happened in the Old Testament. But here's where it correlates with the Isaiah passage. "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." And the angel answers, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." So here we just read the prophecy, and then 700 years later, God fulfills his promise. The child born by the Holy Spirit, by being overshadowed, would be called holy. Not simply because they were a firstborn in a family and set apart to the service of God, but because his life would be wholly directed by God's Spirit, who in both living and dying will be righteous. The point of this interaction is that God is the one acting to bring the Messiah to Israel. God faithfully fulfilled the promise he spoke to Ahaz through the prophet Isaiah. This teaches us that we can trust God to fulfill all his promises found in Scripture. Hear the prophecy in Isaiah, and we're going to look at the prophecy that we read this morning regarding Jesus' ministry. In Isaiah 40, verses 3 through 5, Isaiah spoke, "A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up and every mountain made low, and the rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. And here, Isaiah is using imagery of this king coming down this royal road, coming as a triumphant king to come rescue his people. God is seen figuratively as this king coming down this road. And there would be people that would go before the king and would proclaim that the king is coming. But here, it's not only that that Israel would see the redemption, God's redemption, but that all people, the whole world, would see God's redemption. And the glory of God is the demonstration of his absolute reality. The great sin and that struggle that humanity has is we attempt to take God's glory and make it our own without submitting to Christ Jesus, without submitting to faith. But God had a plan for each one of us in the fulfillment of Jesus Christ. If we turn to John 1, verse 22, John the Baptist was one that was born, that was prophesied over. And he was one that was out in the Judean wilderness, and he preached redemption to turn from their unbelief. He preached to the people, and people from all over would come to him to hear his preaching, to hear his teaching, and then to be baptized in the Jordan River. And so this man that was called by God was sitting there, and some of the religious leaders, they sent some priests and Levites to John, and they're like, we want to find out who this guy is. Because they're looking at the prophecies of the Old Testament, and they're going, is he the Messiah? Is he the Elijah who it's been prophesied that he will come back before the Messiah returns? And so they're waiting in anticipation. And so they send these priests and Levites to John, and they say, who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? And John replies in the words of Isaiah the prophet, I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord. So in the Jewish expectation, understanding or interpreting the Old Testament scripture, there would be, like I said, a return of Elijah before the Messiah. And then Messiah would be a prophet, like as great as Moses. And these final figures were expected to lead and teach Israel and to gather the tribes of Israel all together. And they were to be the final interpreters of the law. But John here, he denies that these are the roles for him. That in fact, it is Jesus who will fulfill both the Messiah and the prophet. John's words are recorded in all four Gospels. And he was the prophet who was calling the people to return from their ways, turn from their unbeliefs, to be baptized as a sign of their repentance. He was announcing the coming of the Mighty One who baptizes with the Holy Spirit and in fire and purification, that sanctification so that we may live holy. And his role was to be that voice crying in the wilderness. It was a self-designation which underscored John's role as witness. His importance was to diminish as Jesus' ministry began to rise. And all what he was to do was to point to the way to Jesus himself. We're going to turn to Isaiah 50. And for another prophecy, and this prophecy is regarding Jesus' death. And it's Isaiah 50. We're going to start in verse 3. It says, I clothe the heavens with darkness and make sackcloth its coverings. The sovereign Lord has given me a well-instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. He awakens me morning by morning, awakens my ear to listen like one being instructed. The sovereign Lord has opened my ears. I have not been rebellious. I have not turned away. I have offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pull out my beard. I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting. So in the book of Isaiah, there was this figure, this person called the servant. And as you read through Isaiah, you see the servant responding to the accusations of Israel of God not being faithful. And as we read through Isaiah, we begin to see this picture of what we call the suffering servant. Here is just a little bit that he would offer his back to those who beat him, his cheek to those who pull out his beard, and did not hide his face from mocking and spitting. This person is obedient and faithful and is extremely confident in his divine calling and ultimate vindication. His mission is centered on proclaiming the word. But his obedience to God leads to both physical and emotional suffering. If we turn to Matthew 27, and I'm sorry for all the flipping back and forth, but I just think it's so cool when we can go to the Old Testament and then we can see the fulfillment in the New Testament. It's Matthew 27, starting in verse 27. Then the governor's soldier took Jesus to the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around them. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And they twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put on his own clothes and then led him away to be crucified. You see some of the same language describing what Jesus experienced was the same language that was used in Isaiah. It was the same treatment. It was what God's servant, God's Messiah, would suffer at the hands of the people he came to save. God provides guides on our spiritual journey. That's the one thing that is so beautiful, is God does not leave us without a roadmap. He does not leave us without road signs, but he puts things along the way that points to Jesus Christ. Prophetic words are guides on our spiritual journey. They are promises which build our faith. Hebrews 11:1 states, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." Think about those original hearers of Isaiah. They had no clue that it would take 700 years for God to fulfill his promises, but they had faith in God to fulfill them. I also think about in the Gospels, we see several times that Jesus prophesied his death and resurrection. He told his disciples this, and really their response is, "La, la, la, I don't want to hear it." But think about, after hearing those prophetic words and then seeing it take place exactly the way Jesus had prophesied it, think about how that would have built their faith, how that would encourage them and strengthen them to continue the mission that God had called them on. They would look back and they would say, "Jesus knew this was going to happen. He's got this under control. He knows that this is part of God's plan of redemption." And therefore, it would encourage them to live as God had called them to live. Our last prophecy is from Isaiah 44, and it's about Jesus' role in the church. Starting in verse 3, it says, I will pour water on a thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. They will spring up like grass in a meadow, like poplar trees by flowing streams. Some will say, I belong to the Lord, and others will call themselves by the name of Jacob. Still others will write on their hands the Lord's and will take the name of Israel. Here, the prophet senses that without the infusion of the Holy Spirit, the life of the people of God, or life of people, is only death and corruption will reign. If without the Holy Spirit, without divine intervention, it is the same spiritual shortcomings that cause the destruction of the nation once and will do it again. When we read through the Old Testament, we see that Israel was in this cycle of falling away from God and then coming back to Him. So their natural tendency was to fall away from God. But without the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives, there was no way for them to live as God called them to live. And Jesus, as He's preparing to leave His disciples, we're going to turn to John 16, verse 7. He's sitting down with His disciples, and these are some of His last parting words. And He says, very truly, I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate, which is the Holy Spirit, will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him to you. So Jesus promised that after His death and resurrection, when He ascended to the Father, that He would send the Holy Spirit and would forever have His presence with Jesus. The prophecy was fulfilled in Pentecost when we look at Acts 2 and the early believers. But this is one example that I think is so amazing. So Peter was one of Jesus' disciples, and before Jesus' death on the cross, he denied even knowing Jesus 3 times, even though he had promised he would never do so. He denies knowing Jesus. Jesus dies, and he's resurrected. He reinstates Peter. And then in Acts 2, there's this outpouring of the Holy Spirit on Peter. And this man became so courageous that he went and he stood in front of the same peoples that condemned Jesus. And he spoke the truth and he showed them that Jesus was the fulfillment of these Old Testament prophecies. He spoke with courage to the point that these teachers of the law, they stepped back and they said, aren't these uneducated fishermen? How can they speak with such authority? And then they remembered that these were the men that were with Jesus. The Holy Spirit empowers us to live as Christ Jesus has called us to live. God continues to fulfill His promise of pouring out His Spirit on His people. He continues to fulfill the promise that He will never leave us nor forsake us. This morning, we've only looked at a couple of prophecies and only focused on the book of Isaiah. But there are prophecies from Genesis and Exodus, Psalms, Daniel, and others. 55 of those, if you have your sermon notes, 55 of those prophecies are on the back where you can also find the fulfillment. And so I want to encourage you this Advent season. If you took 2 to 3 of these prophecies and their fulfillments and read those 2 to 3 each day during Advent, By the time you reach Christmas, you will have read all 55 prophecies. And I want to encourage you to do that during this Advent season. Because when we read Scripture, when we see prophetic words and we see their fulfillment, we are encouraged. We are encouraged to live in the power of the Holy Spirit. And here's the truth. We are all on a spiritual journey. It doesn't matter whether you have not made a commitment to Jesus Christ yet, or whether you have been walking with the Lord all of your life. We are all on a spiritual journey in which we are being formed by the things we allow to influence us. And sometimes we are shaped by the things that encourage us, thoughts and behaviors that create this barrier between us and God. We call that sin. But God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. He was resurrected 3 days later so that we might receive God's forgiveness, that we might receive the gift of salvation. Today, you might see signs that God has placed in your life, inviting you to be in a right relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. Others of us, we have received Scripture as our roadmap and continue our journey towards being more like Jesus. No matter where we are, the Bible continues to point to Jesus, to God's love and faithfulness, and our need for a Savior. Because the truth is even when we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we still need to be reminded that we need a Savior, that we need forgiveness of sin. That's why we partake in communion. It reminds us of our need. The Bible speaks God's promises into our lives. These are prophecies and promises we can believe because God has been faithful to fulfill his promise. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we thank you. We thank you that you are a God that loves us so much, that you would begin to speak your truth from the very beginning of our brokenness, that you would begin to promise that you had a plan of redemption in place. I thank you, God, that you spoke 4,000 years before you fulfilled that promise of bringing the Messiah. I thank you that you continued to speak to your people. Father, light something in our hearts. Bring us to a place of faith and trust. Give us the courage and strength to live as you have called us to live. Lord, open our eyes to the road signs, to the map that you have laid out before us. And give us a yearning and a longing to follow your ways. And if you have never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, with our eyes still closed, I want you to pray with me silently. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. And I ask for your forgiveness. I believe Jesus Christ is your Son. I believe that he died for my sin and that you raised him to life. I want to trust him as my Savior and follow him as Lord from this day forward. Guide my life and help me to do your will. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So if you have never prayed this prayer, and this is the first time that you have prayed this prayer, I just encourage you to tell someone. I would love to hear about it. Our spiritual journey, what's so beautiful, is we don't walk it alone. We walk it with our brothers and sisters. God made it so that we journey together in community. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God. So this morning, I was told my very first year that I was here, which was only last year, that the Christmas season does not begin without a very special song. And so we are going to stand and sing this, ring the bells. I think Linda has something to say too.
I'm just
Are you going to echo me?
I'm just echoing what you already said.
All right. Yes. So we are going to usher in the Advent season with this beautiful tradition. Please stand.